continue looking at Jesus, the story of the Old Testament, and we look specifically at the book of Ruth, I find myself a little bit of a quandary because it's a short book, four chapters, and you would think we've covered books that are 40 or 50 chapters in one evening. Four chapters should be nothing. However, this is such a great story, and virtually every sentence, every verse in this book has significant impact in the story, the small story that is what we call Ruth, but it has significant impact in the big story, the meta-narrative, which is undergirding the entire Bible, which is the story of Jesus Christ. But I'm going to resist the urge to spend more than the allotted time tonight in this little book. And I was told beforehand I've only got a half hour on the recording videotape anyway, so I will keep this to our normal 25 minutes or so. As we get started with the book of Ruth, I want to read just the first five verses of the first chapter to kind of set the stage, and then we'll do a quick overview of the entire book. But here's how it begins. Now, it came about in the days when the judges governed that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the land of Moab with his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem in Judah. Now when they entered the land of Moab and remained there, then Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. They took for themselves Moabite women as wives. The name of one was Orpah, the name of the other, Ruth. And they lived there about 10 years. Then both Mahlon and Chilion also died, and the woman was bereft of her two children and her husband. There's a lot packed into those few verses. But the first thing I want to point out is, though the name given to this book is the name Ruth, it could just as easily be named Naomi. Because as we will see, she is very much the center figure in this book. Or it could be named Boaz. Because as we will see, he is also a very important figure. But, maybe most importantly, it could be named Jesus. Because everything in this book points to Jesus Christ, as we will see. So we have this beginning in where we're told that it started, or that it took place in the days of the judges, when the judges governed. We looked at that last time. And just to remind you, this was a very bleak and dark period in Israel's history. The common theme was there was no king in Israel, and everyone did what was right in his own eyes. It was a period of anarchy. It was a period of great idolatry and God's judgment and wrath upon the people. And they would repent when God raised up a judge, but then as soon as that judge died, people would go their own way and commit great and heinous sins. So it was a very dark and bleak period in the life of Israel. And during this period, the author here tells us that there was a famine in the land, probably a judicial famine, where God was pouring out his wrath upon Israel because of their idolatry, and one of the curses of the Old Covenant was the famine. God would shut up the heavens, and there would be no more rain to come and provide food for the people. So this man, Elimelech, packs up his family after years of famine and moves to Moab. Now, if you know your Jewish history, this was not a particularly good move on Elimelech's part. The Moabites were sworn enemies of Israel. They derived their origin through Lot's incestuous relationship with one of his daughters, if you remember that story. Then when God brought Israel out from slavery to Egypt, Moab would not give them any food and respite, and so God rejected them because they didn't help them on their way out of Egypt. And then King Balak hired a prophet named Balaam to curse Israel. Now, God didn't allow that to happen instead of cursing what he spoke, or blessings, but Moab tried to curse Israel. So this was a pretty telling decision of Elimelech to move his people out of the promised land, and instead of calling upon the Lord for help, instead of calling his own people to repentance for their sin, he moved his family to this pagan land. And one of the results was his two sons, whom he took, married Moabite women, thus violating the covenant of God. While they're there for a 10-year period, Elimelech himself dies, then one of his sons dies, then the other son dies, and Naomi is left in a miserable place. She has experienced famine in her own land, she's been removed to a foreign land, and now her husband and her two sons are dead. She has no protector, no provider, no food. It is an awful situation. And as we will see, this hardship takes root in her heart as she becomes a very, very bitter and angry woman. Well, as the story goes on, she hears that the famine has been lifted in Israel, so she decides to go back to her homeland. And as she's en route with her two daughters-in-law, she stops at one point and says, "You guys need to go back to your own parents. You need to go back to your homeland, to your own gods even, because I have nothing to offer you." She encouraged them strongly, and she says in chapter 1, verse 8, "Go, return to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. May the Lord grant you that you may find rest in the house of her husband." And she kissed them, and they all wept. They said, "We're not leaving you. We want to go with you." Then Naomi's tone changes. She gets a little sarcastic and a little snippy. She says, "Look, I have nothing to give. I don't have any sons to provide as your husbands. And even if by some miracle in my age I were to get pregnant now, would you wait until my kids are old enough to marry you? Go, leave, depart is best for you." And we see where her heart is at the end of verse 13, "No, my daughters, for it is harder for me than for you. For the hand of the Lord has gone forth against me." Two things I want to point out about this. Number one is, she is a better theologian than many, many people today. She understands that none of this happened by accident. The hardship in her life, the death of her husband and sons, the famine in the land, she understands nothing happens in the entire universe apart from God's will. Many people today, when they try to explain why is this happening and how this come about, leave God completely out of the equation, but Naomi knows better than that. However, rather than submitting to his will in contentment, she turns against him. She says, "He's turned against me. His hand is heavy against me. He is now my enemy." So they lifted up their voices and wept again, and Orpah left, but Ruth stayed. She said, "I'm not leaving you. Your people and not my people, your God, my God, I'm going where you go." So they come back to Bethlehem, where Naomi is from, and there's a great stir about. People are excited, they're rejoicing, and they're saying, "Is this Naomi? Is this really her? Has she come back?" And they're excited for her. And Naomi again shows the state of her heart. In verse 20, she says to them, "Do not call me Naomi," which is a word that means pleasant or pleasant one. "Don't call me pleasant. Don't call me Naomi. Call me Mara. For the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, but the Lord has brought me back empty. Why do you call me Naomi, since the Lord has witnessed against me and the Almighty has afflicted me?" Again, we hear the cry of bitterness and anger toward God. "Don't call me pleasant, call me bitter because of the way the Lord has treated me." So they go back to Naomi's property, and they don't have any food. Their particular piece of land is not producing any fruit. And Ruth says, "Why do I not go out and glean from the other lands around?" Because Jewish law required for the Jews not to harvest everything they possibly could. They were to leave the gleanings. They were only to go through the fields once and not twice. And anything that fell on the ground or anything they couldn't gather in the first pass was to be left for the widows and the poor so that they could be provided for. This was sort of their welfare system, if you will. And so Ruth says, "Let me go and glean things." And when she comes back, she has with her a bushel, 30 pounds of barley. And Naomi says, "Wow, that's pretty good work for a day's work. That's more than you can glean if they left 30 pounds out there like this, something is wrong. She says, what happened? Who did you meet? And that's where Ruth says, I met a man named Boaz, and he sent me back with this blessing. And here is where we find really the apex of the entire book, where Naomi, when she sees this huge gift from Boaz to Ruth, her mind begins to change about what is going on. And here's what she says in verse 20 of chapter 2. Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, may he, speaking of Boaz, may he be blessed of the Lord. And now look at what she says about the Lord, who has not withdrawn his kindness to the living and to the dead. This word kindness is the Hebrew word hesed. You're going to speak it in good Hebrew, like hesed, right?
Right, perfect.
This is the word for covenant faithfulness, for the loving kindness of God to his people. What Naomi is saying is, finally, God is remembering. He is not completely abandoned, but he is remembering his blessing, his promise to be kind and gracious to his people. He has not forgotten us completely. He has not withdrawn his hand of mercy, but he is pouring it out upon us. Blessed be this man who is an instrument in God's hand for our good. So Ruth then goes back continually through the harvest period, about another 7 weeks, and brings back the gleanings day in and day out. After the harvest is over, at the end of chapter 2, it says she lived with her mother-in-law, setting up the stage where there's no more harvesting, no more gleaning to be done, and now Naomi and Ruth are once again by themselves. Their food is going to run out. What are they going to do? Naomi is a different woman. She's no longer the bitter one who's only concerned about herself. She's no longer hostile toward God or thinking that God is hostile toward her. She's now thinking of others above herself. In chapter 3, verse 1, we read, then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, my daughter, shall I not seek security for you that it may be well with you? I need to help provide for you. I need to set you up in a situation where you can have a family and a home and live better than we are living here. See how she's thinking now away from herself and to Ruth, who's been faithfully devoted to her all this time. Now, what takes place next is written in a style that includes a tremendous amount of euphemisms and double entendres. This would most certainly get an R rating if it were a movie. It is a very risky move by Naomi. She says to Ruth, here's what I want you to do. I want you, first of all, take a bath, clean yourself up, put on some perfume, put on some attractive clothes, and go to where Boaz is. He is out at the threshing floor, and he will be there tonight. Now think about this one. Boaz owned the property. He was the king. He was the ruler of this land. He had servants who did the threshing and so on. It wasn't normal practice for the head of the home to be out doing the work. That's why he had workers. How is it that Naomi knew that tonight Boaz would be there? We're not told, but she made it her business to know that he would be out there tonight. And she says, go and find out, go and hide yourself so that nobody sees you. And as they're eating and drinking and making merry after a hard day's work, take note to where Boaz lies down, because it's going to be pitch dark. It's not like around here where we've got street lights and porch lights and things where everybody can see. As soon as the sun goes down and gets dark, you can't see anything in front of you. So you need to make a good mark as to where Boaz is and go uncover his feet and lay down next to him. If you trace that term through the Old Testament, the innuendo is very, very clear what Naomi is suggesting. And she says, go lay down at his feet, and he will tell you what to do. You do it is what he tells you. So Boaz works hard, he eats, he drinks, he he's satisfied, it's been a good day, the famine is over, and he's got plenty of work, and he's worked hard, and he's eaten, and so he collapses, he's asleep, and he's stirring in the night, and suddenly realizes there's someone down by his feet, and he says, so spread your covering over your maid, for you are a redeemer. Again, if you trace these words through and realize what she is saying here, she has just given Boaz a marriage proposal. Think of it. In a patriarchal society, a woman asking the hand of marriage of a man. And in the culture that in which they lived, they didn't have to wait and have a big marriage ceremony a year later in a church somewhere. They could have gotten married right then and there. She is offering herself to him in marriage. Notice how he responds in verse 10 of chapter 3. Then he said, "May you be blessed of the Lord, my daughter. You have shown your last kindness to be better than the first by not going after young men, whether rich or poor." She said, you could have had anybody. She obviously was a very attractive woman because she didn't have anything to give them. So he's saying, look, you could have won the hearts of young men, you could have won the hearts of rich men, but instead, you chose an old coot like me. That's a blessing, better than any blessing you've given me. "Now, my daughter, do not fear. I will do whatever you ask. For all my people in the city know that you are a woman of excellence. Now, it is true that I am a redeemer. However, there is a relative closer than I. Remain this night, and when morning comes, if he will redeem you, good, let him redeem you. But if he does not wish to redeem you, then I will redeem you as the Lord lives." Taking a vow there. "Lie down until morning." So she stays until it gets just light enough that she can get out of there, but it's not light enough that anybody knows who she is, because this was a typical setting for prostitution in that day, where men would be out around the threshing field, and the harlots would come and just join them in the middle of that field, and he doesn't want to destroy her honor. So he says, as soon as it gets a little bit light, get out of here so that nobody will know that you were here. Then he goes to the town the next day, and he finds the guy that is the closer relative. And here's where it gets a little tricky. If you trace through the kinsman redeemer jobs in the Old Testament, this situation does not fit any of them perfectly. And this is not a levirate marriage either, where the brother is required to take the woman. So we don't know exactly all that's going on here. Boaz is called a redeemer, a kinsman redeemer, but it's not the typical setting. And again, we don't know exactly how the custom works in this sense, but we do know that Boaz says, there's one guy who's in line ahead of me to marry. So he goes into town the next day while the business is done, and he tracks that guy down and says, Naomi is back, and she has land, and redeem her if you like, or else I will. I will buy her land from her and give it to her, and I will inherit her household, or you can. You're first in line. And the guy says, this is great, because this is how it would work. He would buy the land from her, give it back to her, and Naomi would be set for the rest of her life. But when Naomi died, he would get the land. So it's really a no-lose proposition for him. She didn't have any male heirs, so it's all going to be his. But then Boaz says, great, go do that, except let me fill you in on this part too. There's this Ruth gal, this Moabitess, and she is part of the package. And suddenly this other redeemer says, that's going to get too messy with my inheritance for my children. Never mind, you take her. So he passes on his opportunity, and Boaz is the one who is allowed to redeem her. Just a side note, there is a textual variant. There is another reading of this where it's not that Ruth is included, but that Boaz says, I'm going to marry the Moabitess, and her heir, our heir, will be the heir of Naomi and of Elimelech, and we will get the land. So it's possible that the reason this guy turned it down was because Boaz was saying, I'm going to marry Ruth, we're going to have children, and if we have a son, he will inherit the land, and we'll get it back, so it's a lose-lose proposition there. That could be the way it's typically translated. Either way, he passes, and Boaz is now able to redeem Naomi's Naomi and the property and Ruth, and he marries her. And in chapter 4, verse 13, we read, so Boaz took Ruth, she became his wife, he went into her, and the Lord enabled her to conceive, and she gave birth to a son. And now look how this begins to wrap up. The women said to Naomi, blessed is the Lord who has not left you without a redeemer today, and may his name become famous in Israel. May he also be to you a restorer of life and a sustainer of your old age, for your daughter-in-law who loves you and is better to you than seven sons has given birth to him. Then Naomi took the child and laid him in her lap and became his nurse. The neighbor women gave him a name, saying, a son has been born to Naomi. So they named him Obed. There's a very quick overview of this book of Ruth. I want to highlight a few of the things that jump out at us as pointing directly to Jesus Christ. First of all is this whole concept of the Redeemer, the kinsman Redeemer, the one who buys back what wasn't his originally, but he buys back because of his love, and it cost him something. It took great expense for Boaz, even though he was a wealthy man, it was very expensive for him to buy this land from Naomi to redeem her and Ruth. And of course, the whole concept of redeemer and the idea of putting forth great expense to buy back that which was lost points straight to Jesus Christ. Boaz is a type of Christ in that sense. Also consider the fact of who Ruth is. Ruth was a Moabite. She was the enemy. She was one of those that God said, no Moabite may ever come into the temple of the Lord for 10 generations, or to the tabernacle of the Lord for 10 generations. And yet, she joins the covenant community and is part of the lineage of Christ. We go back to chapter 1, probably the most famous portion of this book that is often quoted at weddings, for instance, in verses 16 and following, when Ruth is saying, I will not leave you, I'm going to be with you, Ruth said, do not urge me to leave you or to turn back from following you, for where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. Thus may the Lord do to me, and worse, if anything but death parts you and me. In the Hebrew, this is in a chiastic structure. That is, there's A and A prime, there's B and B prime, and there's C. And the first part of verse 16, which says, do not urge me to leave you, is in parallel with, if anything but death parts me. And it keeps moving to the center. And the center verse, the center statement in this chiasm is, your people, your God first, your people, my people, your God, my God. And if you have the New American Standard, you'll notice that there's no verb in that section. The shall be is in italics, meaning it's not there in the original. The reason that is important is she's not saying your people will be my people. She's saying they are my people. She's not saying your God will be my God. She's saying your God, my God. What she's saying is, I am going to come back with you because I have been persuaded. Now, Naomi does not model good godly behavior all the way through the story. But she has obviously taught Ruth the truth of who Yahweh is. And at some point during that 10 years, Ruth gets it and says, he's now my God. I'm going to serve him. And I must go back with you. Not even so much of her loyalty to Naomi, but because she has already committed, your God is my God. Your people are my people. So I will come back with you. She is converted. She is a member of God's covenant people, a Moabite, an outcast, a Gentile, of course symbolizing all of us who are Gentiles, who are outcasts, who are far off and cut off, and now have been brought into in chapter 4, in verse 11, the people, the elders who are witnessing this kinsman redeemer process, in verse 11, they offer this blessing. They said, "We are witnesses. May the Lord make the woman who is coming into your home like Rachel and Leah, both of whom built the house of Israel." Ruth goes on to become a mother who gives birth to the lineage that brings forth David and ultimately Jesus. Just as Rachel and Leah were foundational in the household of God, so is Ruth. They say, "May you achieve wealth," or actually, "May you achieve power in Ephrathah." Now, I know that word Ephrathah you may think is just in the Bible so that we pastors have something to trip over for Christmas. But there are two other places where Bethlehem and Ephrathah come together. There's three total. One is here. The second one is David. In 1 Samuel 17, David is, we're told, is from Bethlehem and Ephrathah. And then, of course, there's the prophecy in Micah. "You Bethlehem, small clan, from you will come one who is the ruler of my people." So do you see how this is all pointing toward Christ? First David, and then Christ. We have Naomi going from fullness to emptiness, and then great blessing again. And that's a parable for life, is it not? There's a time for all of us that we think, hey, life is great, life couldn't be any better, but then hardships come, difficulties come, and we begin to say sometimes, where is God in all this? What is he doing? We must guard against becoming bitter and hostile like Naomi did, but also realize at the end the joy will be greater than it ever was before. Finally, I want to bring your attention to this guy Elimelech. His name means, "My God is my king." That's what Elimelech means. Living in a period when there was no king in Israel, and everyone did what was right in their own eyes, including him by taking his people to Moab. At the end, we find the anticipation of the coming kingdom. Because where I left off in chapter 4, verse 17, after a son has been born to Naomi, and they named him Obed, we read, "He is the father of Jesse, the father of David. Now these are the generations of Perez. To Perez was born Hezron, to Hezron was born Ram, and Ram Amminadab, and Amminadab was born Nashon, and Nashon Salmon, and Solomon was born Boaz, and to Boaz Obed, and to Obed was born Jesse, and to Jesse David." And what we learn here is the reason why Ruth is in our Bibles, ultimately, and what the author wants us to see, is that Boaz, this redeemer, who takes this Gentile pagan woman to be his wife, the two together become the ancestors to none other than the greatest king of Israel, David, who of course is the antitype of the greatest king of the entire universe, which is Jesus Christ. That's the reason Ruth is put into your Bible. I would encourage you to take the time to really study it, dig in, because there are so many portions of this book. Every verse really does point toward the setting up of the Davidic kingdom and ultimately Jesus' kingdom. And next week,